Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good whatever time of day it is. Thank you for tuning in to Conversations with Dr. Don. This show is produced and broadcast from Portland, Oregon in the USA. For your first-time viewers, Conversations with Dr. Don is an ongoing series of one-hour standalone talk shows where I interview interesting people like most of you out there about who they are as unique, one-of-a-kind individuals, and about whatever it is that we have decided to talk about. And this evening, my guest, Vern Turner, is going to talk about any and everything under the sun. I was reading Vern on the internet for a long time, and I got the urge to respond to some of the stuff he was saying, which was so right on and so powerful. I'm a political and social justice junkie anyhow, and his writing speaks for itself, as he'll tell you later on as we talk some more. And thank you for coming on.
It's my pleasure.
My pleasure.
Nice yeah. visit, yes.
Had him fly in from Texas.
Yeah.
Got him at the airport this afternoon yeah. and almost lost him.
Yeah, almost disconnected, but it's a beautiful town. You've driven me around and shown me this beautiful city of Portland.
But don't come here. We have too many foreigners.
Yep.
In
okay.
How are you feeling right now?
I'm feeling pretty good.
Pretty yeah. good. You're not nervous?
No. I used to teach high school science, so being on television is not a big deal.
Oh,
this
rats.
Is really safe.
So I'm the only one that's nervous. That's not fair.
Yeah, well, you're the boss. You have to be nervous.
So we're going to have a good show this evening. We're doing a two-hour, a two-part show. The first hour, we'll talk about one subject for the most part, and the second hour, we'll talk about another subject. But we'll connect the two of them in case you happen to see only the second hour and miss the first hour. So let's see. The roots of evil are one of two, our most productive and equitable times. So let's start with what I call the bio section, where I talk about who you are personally. So the viewers will have some sort of an idea where you're coming from, and they have not had the privilege of talking with you for a couple of hours before the show started, so they don't know the kind of things you're going to say, but I don't.
I don't either. It depends on what you ask me. I'm a very spontaneous person that way.
Yeah, and of course, if I ask you a question that you don't want to answer, I have a trick question now, okay. maybe another one later on, but right. let me start with my first trick question.
Okay.
All right. If I were to ask your best friend, who is Vern? What would your best friend say? Be your best friend. Say, Vern is what?
Vern is sincere and dependable.
Uh-huh.
I think that everybody knows where I come from. My life is on my sleeve. My heart is on my sleeve. I don't suffer fools, mm-hmm. and I don't beat around the bush. Some people, in fact, one of the fellows who wrote a foreword in my book called me blunt, and I guess I can go with that. I'm pretty blunt. Save space. I don't beat around the bush. It makes the publishers happier.
Uh-huh. Sure made me happy.
Yeah, good.
And you'll get more information about how to go to Facebook and see what Vern's about,
yep.
and it's a treat to read anything that he's written. And he's going to talk some more as the hour goes on about the books he's written, so that you get an idea where I'm coming from when I praise you highly for
wow.
what you write. Yeah,
it's really thankful. Thank you.
Yeah. When and where were you born?
I was born in East Cleveland, Ohio, in 1942. Yeah, that makes me 74 and change, and. We lived in East Cleveland until I was 12 years old, 13 years old, and then we moved to an east side suburb called Eastlake, where I graduated high school and went on from there to a life of questionable stardom.
Why were you born? Why?
Well, because my father and mother exchanged gametes. They... you know, and one of them worked, you know, so here I am.
So is there some deeper reason that you're on this planet?
No, I think I can't be that arrogant. I just have to say that I was a function of chance.
I like to think that there's something more than I'm aware of, and I guess at it. And I think I try to live up to what I think that reason is. And for me, it's being a kind person, yeah.
Yeah.
That's my reason.
Well, I think we all end up having a purpose, or at least we choose one or try. Some don't, some do. We did, I think, in our respective lives. And, you know, I think the most rewards that I can say personally were from, as an educator in science. I taught anatomy in a medical school, and I taught grades 6 through 12 in public schools in science and English. And it was the time of my life. You know, I had a great time. The kids were great for the most part, and they kept me from being an old man.
Okay, and I'm glad when you look at me when you talk to me. Occasionally, I'd have a guest who's fascinated with their image on the monitor, and they're talking to me and looking at themselves on the screen. But
no, I already been there. I know what he looks like.
Anything significant about your racial, national, or cultural heritage that's worth
mentioning?
About?
Yeah. No, I guess only that. My mother is the daughter of Ukrainian immigrants who spoke no English when they got here in 1916. And my mother went to elementary school speaking no English in Cleveland, Ohio. And by the time she graduated high school, she graduated with honors in English. So that is a, you know, one of those anecdotes that I would that I had indeed transmitted to a lot of my students, too, when they were struggling with language arts and writing and reading and listening. So anybody can do it if they put their mind to it, and we have given them the opportunity to do so. So,
did you retain any of the native tongue?
No, she didn't either. My mom was, my grandfather, bless his heart, was one of those fellas who said, "We're here in America and we're going to speak English." And that's what they did. They went to school and they all learned to speak English and Ukrainian and Polish and Georgian and Russian were spoken amongst their ethnic friends in the community because, you know, Cleveland was a potpourri of ethnic enclaves, conclaves. And so, but we, you know, all of us kids, and we were not speaking any European languages.
Do you have any connection now with thoughts about Ukraine and what's been going on in recent years with Ukraine anymore?
It's just you know, the Ukraine has some really interesting history that goes all the way back to when the Polish knights were in command or at least rule that part of Europe. And they've been bantied about by different wars and conflicts between the Poles and the Russians and the Germans and the Teutonic Knights that also spent some time there. So they've been, you know, their culture is very much multifaceted. And I think the Russians are just using them to exhibit their own bulliness, you know, and Putin was, you know, just thumping his chest. That's just my opinion.
So religion, what was religion going on there? Some form of Roman Catholicism?
It's Russian Orthodox.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah, which is a kind of a spin off of Greek Orthodox.
Uh-huh. And you said a few words about your formal education. Is there a little more you can say about that?
Well, I graduated from Ohio University with a degree in biology, with a minor in chemistry and English. I worked 6 years in Ohio and then moved to San Diego and worked there for a couple of years and went back to graduate school. And I received a Master of Science in Zoology from San Diego State University in San Diego in 1974.
How'd you acquire this fascination with science to that extent?
I think it was always there. My father, I think, wanted me to be an engineer. And then they went and made the fatal mistake of buying me a set of encyclopedias. And that die was cast, I think, after that.
Hey, I think you told me in a matter of a few years you absorbed the encyclopedias.
Yeah, it didn't take long. I just got so absorbed, and I read them in less than 2 years.
Less than 2 years. Does your head hurt when you think about it now?
No, my head hurts when I, for other things, which I hope we'll discuss.
So yes, of course. And we know what you've done in your work life. Are you working anymore or are you retired?
I retired from teaching school in 2007. Mm-hmm. And thought I was going to be a gentleman farmer and golfer. But then the local newspaper kept printing these editorials that were so right-wing, I just couldn't stand it. It was so libertarian stuff that this writer was feeding the locals where I live.
Yeah.
And so I started writing letters to the editor and said, hey, you know, he can't get away with this. This is not true. Here's the truth. Here are the facts. You know, why is he being misled? And by, the phone rings. And it's the editor of the paper. And he said, okay, put up or shut up. How would you like to write an opposing column every week? And I said, done. And so that was really what started my fourth career, really. And I started writing columns. And I wrote, in fact, my first book called Voter's Guide to National Salvation is a compendium of a lot of those first articles, along with some editorial opinions attached. It started right around the time that Obama was nominated and then won the election in 2009. Uh-huh. And I covered that and tried to keep it an honest dialogue in that paper. Uh-huh. In Marble Falls, Texas.
And you're still writing?
Yeah, the paper folded eventually. They even though our editorial section received a couple of state journalism awards for the best small town newspaper editorial page, and I'm proud to have been a part of that. But I also connected through a friend with the editors at the Oklahoma Observer. Mm-hmm. In Oklahoma City, and they still publish my periodical.
Even now?
Period. Yeah, I don't write weekly, but I write an article every 2-3 weeks, and they publish it still. Yeah,
I've got some of them here on my own that I kept to talk to you about.
Thanks.
But you got a whole bunch more to talk about anyhow. When you see his articles, as you go to,
Facebook.
Facebook.
Yeah, Facebook. Yeah, you can go on Facebook, and I post them there. If you friend me on Facebook, I will connect you to Vern's Readers, which is where I post my essays, and you can have a look at not only the most recent ones, but all the ones that I've published there in the past. I'm working on a fifth book, so I don't know if it's going to be fiction or if it's going to be more of the same, but it's going to collect a lot of the current events that are swamping all of us these days, and we'll see how that turns out.
Oh, I'm looking forward to it. So, you have a partner, boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, wife.
I have a wife. I have a wife, and her name is Elaine, and she is a retired lawyer.
Uh-huh.
She was a labor and discrimination lawyer of some merit, both in California and in Colorado.
Uh-huh.
We have been married 26 years, and we enjoy traveling, and we raise three beautiful Maine Coon cats.
What kind of cats?
Maine Coon cats.
What kind of cat is that?
They are one of the original American-only breeds that is a companion of the Scottish Wildcat and some Scandinavian lineages that were brought over in the 18th century and have, generated this pedigree of a spectacular, large family of group of cats.
Sort of like the folks in New Orleans where I grew up. I don't know where we all came from, but I'm the result of something like that. Louisiana Creoles.
Nowadays, now it's you have to be really careful about the breeding because the breeding stocks are getting interbred a lot, so you have to be careful.
And you still got them?
Yeah, these guys, we've had them all checked out. They get DNA analysis now. And yeah, so you can find out if they have hip dysplasia issues or lobulated kidney problems. So yeah, it's complicated. But we love them to bits.
Yeah. Yeah, political persuasion on the continuum, left to right, or wherever you are, or you're on the same side as Donald Trump.
I'm probably the antithesis of Donald Trump. I'm definitely not centrist. I'm not center right. I think I'm very much an FDR Democrat, and that probably pushes me closer to Bernie Sanders and his operating philosophy, at least the one that he presented during his campaign season. Because I believe in my fellow Americans, that, and I also believe in their rights, and I believe in their, I believe in the nation's worthiness to see to it that certain things escape the maw of the profit motive, like healthcare and education. Why do those have to be profit centers? So that's pretty much where I am.
What have you got against profit?
Nothing. Only when it's harmful to. Yeah, I know what you're doing. You're baiting. Throw another worm on the hook.
Yeah.
But the thing is that you know, when you add profit motive to something as elegant as educating our children, it becomes an opportunity for corruption, and we've seen that all along. George Bush's No Child Left Behind is a swamp of corruption and failure at every turn. And it cost the taxpayer hundreds of millions of dollars and achieved absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. That's why.
What's the difference between sympathy and empathy and compassion?
Well, I think empathy has more to do with sharing something with someone that have had similar experiences. Uh-huh. Sympathy is merely an emotional outreach to somebody who has had a tough time in some areas.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you have any memberships in political, social, or civic organizations worth mentioning?
Not really.
Mm-hmm.
I give a few bucks here and there to the Democratic committees and congressional committees, but I'm going to become, though, a charter member of the Austin, Texas chapter of the Progressive Democrats of America. They've asked me to be one of their bloggers as, you know, as we spread the network out across the nation.
Are you a friend of Jim Hightower?
No, I've never met him, but we're friends. I was also somebody who's also my literary hero in terms of political writing was Molly Ivins.
Oh my gosh.
Who is unfortunately deceased, and I never got a chance to meet her, but I have all her books.
Yeah, yeah. Any persons from the past are alive today that you particularly admire or admired or look up to it, anything like that?
Yeah, one of the people that I admire today who unfortunately has gotten really bad press from the right-wing screamers is Jimmy Carter. The guy turns out to be one of the most noble Americans this country's ever produced in all of his beneficial work that he's done since he's been president.
Give me an example or two of what he's done.
Habitat for Humanity,
yes,
has been his main thrust in terms of doing civic duty. And he and Rosalind both just roll up their sleeves and get to work. You know, no finer example of being humble and being, and I'm not a religious person, but for him, he's walking the walk of Christianity. And he's one of the few politicians of any stripe that does that. And so he definitely is one of my admired heroes. Another would be the Roosevelts, Teddy and FDR. If you read Teddy Roosevelt, he had his issues about being an imperialist and all that. However, he also advocated universal health care. He also advocated free education. He also advocated all the things in his political agenda that FDR implemented with the New Deal. And of course, Franklin did much more. But, you know, those guys, they knew the score. You know, they knew that capitalism by itself was a thin eggshell. Yeah. And they knew that they had to do something to keep it from being crushed by the weight of greed.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else that you admire?
Yeah, there are a lot of people. I mean, I thought that Bob Feller was one of the best pitchers I ever saw. I think that I'm a sports fan, of course, and I really enjoy almost all kinds of sports. But in terms of the great people that have ever lived, certainly Mohandas Gandhi is one of them. We're fortunate enough to be alive when he was.
Yeah.
I think that some people have been overrated with their fame and fortune. Certainly Ronald Reagan is overrated. I think he's one of the most overrated presidents this country's ever produced. And I think also, if you look at Winston Churchill, yeah, he did some courageous things during the war that really gave the Brits a moral support and fiber. But as a social entity, not so much.
After World War II, he just disappeared, huh?
Well, yeah, there's a good reason for that. He was against what the Labor Party did after the war. Uh-huh. Did you know that in 1946, the first piece of legislation that the British Parliament passed after the end of the war was to install universal health care? And they did that because they thought that everybody, even the rich, paid the price and the sacrifice for fighting that war, and that everybody had the right to receive the country's largesse in the form of their health care.
We still don't
do that.
When are we going to do that?
Hopefully in the next 4 years.
Mm-hmm. You're going to vote for Hillary?
Yes.
Why?
Because there is no other alternative.
Okay.
Frankly, people say, "Oh, I don't like Hillary." Well, okay, I don't like her either, what I see as a persona. But you know what? I'm not voting for the star of the week. I'm voting for somebody who can govern this country.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, all this other baggage and BS that the right wing and Republican generated media has trying to produce to get her put in jail. It's just ludicrous. They've been after them, the Clintons, for 30 years,
yeah.
And they have come up with nothing. No indictments, nothing. So I don't even want to consider that part of the deal. The thing is that matters most is the down ticket that we as a nation absolutely, positively have to replace the current Congress, which has been the most do-nothing Congress in our history. Truman's do-nothing Congress, right?
Mm-hmm.
Passed 8 times more legislation than this Congress, the 113th. So, you know, these guys have done all racism all the time. They can say what words they want, but the bottom line is we're not going to pass any legislation as long as that guy's in the White House.
What,
they said it.
What will happen if Trump is the next president?
I can't even imagine. I just can't imagine. If he does what his mouth says he's going to do, the world, not just the United States.
But he says any and everything, so, all right.
Maybe that's my point, is that since nobody will have confidence in what he says, and we saw what happens today and yesterday, last Friday, when the financial world gets a little bit jiggled, you know, the value of our economy drops. Dow Jones lost 600 points on Friday after the Brits voted to leave the EU. So you got a clown like Donald Trump in there saying this today and that tomorrow. What do you think that, does that represent the kind of stability that our financiers want? I don't think so.
Why does he have such a high number of votes in the primaries?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Somebody just asked me that. And the demographic that he is collecting are people who view authoritarianism as their saving grace. Mm-hmm. And he says everything that they've been harboring all their lives, so the racism, the bigotry, the misogyny, the xenophobia of other nationalities and races.
And that's all fear-driven.
And that's all fear-driven. And he feeds that. He feeds that beast in those people, and they follow him like he's the golden calf. His arrogance, it was so arrogant for him to stand up there and look in the camera and say, I could shoot somebody dead on Fifth Avenue in New York City and my poll numbers would go up. Now, to me, you know, when somebody says something like that, I got a real problem with his ability to lead my nation. And the people who, I used to live in San Diego, and yeah, there's this place in San Diego called Point Loma, and it's just absolutely, you've been there. It's a beautiful peninsula that sticks out in the Pacific Ocean, cradles San Diego Bay. And on top of that is Rosecrans National Cemetery. And I think about places like that and how those guys who are pushing up those white headstones would feel if somebody like Donald Trump was ever allowed to be the commander-in-chief. It would be the ultimate disgrace to all of our fallen warriors ever.
So then what are you going to do to be sure that that doesn't happen?
I'm going to keep doing what I do. I write books. I write articles. I come on and do things like this. I speak to clubs around where I live and try to keep in the conversation and keep the conversation sane, fair. Even though I have a bias, clearly, I still don't want to be, I don't want to see myself going over the top and becoming one of those screamers that I loathe so from the other side.
So, looks like we should take a break and get into the meat of the interview after break time. So, shall we take a break now, Mr. Director? Hello, we're back. Thanks for staying tuned. And for you viewers who missed the opening of the show, Conversations with Dr. Don is an ongoing series of one-hour standalone talk shows where I interview interesting people like most of you out there about who they are as unique, one-of-a-kind individuals and about whatever it is we have decided to talk about. And my guest this evening, Vern Turner, is interesting for a number of reasons, and we've touched on a lot. And there's a lot more we're going to talk about, okay? So now let's go back to, I asked you the question by email, why did you choose that title, The Roots of evil. And you said, I didn't choose this title. Well, I apologize for that.
That's
I shouldn't
okay.
ask that question. what does that mean, the roots of evil? What is the meaning of the term evil?
Well, I think it has to be an anthropomorphic term, meaning that it applies to humans especially. And I think that somebody who is intent on creating harm for other humans, or other living things for that matter, just for the thrill of it, or wantonly causing havoc and harm, you know, like the kid who pulls the wings off of house flies, you know, and laughs about it, or kids who step on frogs, you know. Those things in my book are evil, because that means that they are wasting a life for the sake of their own entertainment. Now, taken to the extreme level, where you have the Holocaust in Europe in the 1930s and 40s, and that takes that evil, yeah, and now you're looking through the bottom of the funnel, and you're seeing how it can manifest itself on a grand scale.
So I wonder how much of those kinds of behaviors can a human being engage in that would allow us to reasonably say that this person is evil. Is Obama's Tuesday meetings with his staff deciding who to kill next on the world?
Yeah, that's a really good question, and it's also very complicated, because there's so much at stake in that answer. It's not just herding a bunch of people onto boxcars and sending them to the ovens. It's because you're afraid of them. That's not the case here. I'm not going to defend it, but I'm going to tell you that he, as Commander-in-Chief, is fighting George Bush's war still, and he's doing the best he can. Instead of carpet bombing a village, he is trying to pinpoint the guys who are trying to blow our people up.
So then, in certain instances, it's okay to kill another human being.
If it's war, it is. It has to be.
There's been no war declared now.
Well, that is a point of conjecture, isn't it?
Of course.
You know, the Congress has been flat on their backsides since the Korean experience.
Yes.
And hasn't declared war. They gave the president the power to put troops on the ground anywhere he wants. And every president since Harry Truman has done that, uh-huh. except Eisenhower, of course. Uh-huh. He pulled people back. So, you know, it's a little more complex than just, is it good or is it evil in this case? Tough question, though.
Yes, tough question. Now, you talked about money, and one of your pieces that I have here, and I thought, money, the meme, becoming the driving force in everything we do, money, is money a root of evil?
It's certainly one of them, because the people who use money and economics as a lever to create the havoc that we talked about earlier, to create the wanton harm against other people or peoples, you know, societies, then I got to think that certainly is a contributing factor to the definition of evil in this case.
So what
I hope I'm not trying to just sound like I'm trying to talk around it. Mm-hmm. You know, money is a wonderful thing when it's used for good things, but when it's used specifically to create death and destruction, then I got a problem with it.
Is there too much money around or what?
No, there's not enough. The one of the things that is in conflict right now in Europe especially and here in the United States is the fact that there's plenty of money. The offshore banks are sinking under the weight of all of the American dollars sitting there. Some estimates are that there is $35 trillion in untaxed largesse sitting mm-hmm. in offshore banks, and that money is owned by less than 400 people. Not all of which are Americans, but most of them are. So
So there's too
there's
much
plenty
money?
Of money. What can you do with $35 trillion?
You know what? What can be done about too much money?
Well, it can be spent.
Uh-huh.
And it can be spent like John Maynard Keynes says it should be, which fuels the pump of creation, innovation, uh-huh. and well-being. You know, in the 1950s and 60s, when we were taxing our richest people to the tune of 90%, we had the lowest unemployment rate.
Yeah.
We had the highest labor pay rates between the top earners and the middle class. The middle class was born and grew in the 50s. And we weren't at war after we left Korea. And I thought, golly, what a nice idea. Everybody had a new car. Everybody bought a house. Everybody had a new refrigerator. And there were 55% of our workforce were union. And
you had one wage earner in families.
And now, if you look at the 1956 GOP political platform, you would find that they were advocating unions, strong unions. They were advocating universal health care. They were advocating free education. They were pro living wage, and they were against the military-industrial complex. Eisenhower's swan song, which I've watched now 20 times, you know, his last speech. I watched the whole thing, not just the last, you know, few phrases. And he basically warned the world about letting the military-industrial complex influence government decisions and policy as at a national and international level. Gee, I guess nobody listened.
What's the alternative? Some form of socialism rather than capitalism?
I don't think you can say one or the other. I think you got to say both. I think that the word socialism is still has echoes of distrust from the Cold War era, when in fact it's none of that.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have white, like the Scandinavian countries have, a democratic socialism, then you get to first base, and your people are healthy, and your people are educated, and you know you can do just about anything you want.
We need some adjectives here.
Yes.
So what kind of socialism are we talking about? Or what kind of capitalism? Monopoly capitalism? Crony capitalism on one hand?
Well, we already have crony capitalism. We already have monopolistic capitalism because they've stopped enforcing the Taft-Hartley bill or law.
People don't realize
the Sherman Antitrust Act is history. Yeah. And it's because of the lobbying. The money.
Money. Comes back again.
And it all, you know, I've got this in my books, especially this one.
Which one?
Racing to the Brink, the End Game for Race and Capitalism, and also Killing the Dream, America's Flirtation with Third World Status. These two books cover the history of how capitalism has become the the basis for wrong-headed economics. Mm-hmm. Wrong-headed meaning Milton Friedman and the Chicago University Economic Department of the 50s, 60s, and 70s that have been pushing austerity only, they've been pushing social service cuts, eliminating unions, canceling public education. All those things are part of that fundamental mistake of supply-side economics. Milton Friedman won a Nobel Prize in economics for screwing people, because when the RCIA went in, and you can look this up, I mean, this is not my word, you can read Naomi Klein's book, Shock Doctrine, and you'll find that the Chicago economic team went right into Chile after Pinochet was installed by RCIA, and that's exactly what they did. They sold off all of their assets to private investors. It used to be owned by the state, or by the people. they cut the labor unions, they cut all the social services, and the nation of Chile crashed. Not only was it a horrible, almost fratricidal dictatorship, but economically it cratered. And that's documented. I'm not making this up. So when you talk about money in the sense of how you perceive it as an economist, I think you got to understand that it's the guy who's down on the shop floor or in the field who's generating the income for the guys at the top. Uh-huh. And when the guys at the top spurn or turn their nose up at the fellows who are making them rich, then you end up headed toward a revolution. And revolutions are always bad news.
The American Revolution is still going on.
To some extent.
Yeah. What persons from history are alive today that you would consider evil? This is a tough question. Hitler.
Yeah, certainly.
Stalin.
Pretty much. He was.
Truman.
No.
The nuclear bombs on Japan wasn't enough.
He was a product of his time.
Chairman Mao, the revolution.
No, you know what? He had his shortcomings, but I've been to China. Uh-huh. And I've visited, and I've talked with forthcoming Chinese nationals there. Uh-huh. And I've stood in Tiananmen Square, and I've been to the Forbidden City and all those things. The Chinese are eternal. What I mean by that is they go and screw up, and then they figure it out, and they fix it. And they know that they have much more work to do. They know that if they want to fix it this time, that just being an advocate of Mao's version of communism isn't going to work. They figure that out.
Yeah.
So now they're trying to, play both ends against the middle to some extent and let capitalism enter that realm while the politicians still try to hold on to power.
With some success.
With some success, a lot of success.
How about Pol Pot, Cambodia?
Bad guy.
Idi Amin.
Very bad guy, extremely bad guy.
Netanyahu.
Misguided.
Uh-huh.
He's trying to start a war with Iran.
So is he evil?
I don't know. I won't go that far.
How about Kissinger?
I don't think so. I don't think you could use the term evil in the same sense.
Christopher Columbus.
That's a little harder question because he brought so much pain and suffering to the New World.
Yeah.
And really did start the ball rolling towards slavery. The first thing Christopher Columbus did was plant a stalk of sugar cane in the Dominican Republic. And sugar, and as you'll see in my book, is the first chapter of Racing to the Brink. Sugar growing in the New World was the first step towards slavery, and capitalism as driven by slavery in the New World.
Evil, evil, evil.
That's pretty bad stuff.
Yeah. What do you think were our best times in America?
Well, we've probably had a few. I think I would start with the years right after the Gilded Age, the first Gilded Age in the early 20th century.
Yeah.
When we woke up to the fact that you couldn't have robber barons running the show and have your country that you took so much pride in, and you just finished a civil war.
We're close to that nowadays,
yeah,
aren't we, robber barons?
Well, yeah, but different. But yeah, I get it's getting there. The thing is that there were no labor laws of any sort. It was all exploitive. There were no labor unions to speak of. In fact, labor unions were the outgrowth of the pre-Gilded Age.
Yeah,
the robber baron era. And I think we started making progress. It took dramatic events like the Ludlow Massacre in Colorado, mm-hmm, that killed 26 people by our own hands, blue on blue, the Rockefellers. That's their little silk paper hearts. Funded the Colorado National Guard to go break that strike down, a coal miner strike in Ludlow, Colorado. And they did. And they murdered people in their beds, men, women and children. And the shock of that massacre generated labor laws and child labor laws that are still on the books today. And that, so it's too bad it took all that blood to make our Congress wake up to the fact that they were underwriting savagery.
So what's our Congress doing nowadays?
They're nothing. This Congress has passed 1/8 of the legislation that the Truman Do-Nothing Congress passed.
Say that again.
I'll say it the other way. Truman's Do-Nothing Congress, infamously said Do-Nothing by the press, passed 8 times more legislation than the 113th Congress that we currently enjoy. So these guys, though, are a different set of cat. They are following the lead of Mitch McConnell, who not too many weeks after Barack Obama lifted his hand off the Bible said, it's on record, or you've seen it on TV, the number one priority of the Republican Party is to make Barack Obama a one-term president. And McCarthy, the number two in the House of Representatives, said, oh yeah. He said, we all got together on inauguration night and said, we're not going to help him. We're not going to do anything that facilitates this president, his administration. We want, in other words, they wanted him to fail. To me, that's sedition. You know, yeah. I mean, you're asking for, you know, strong words and adjectives. How about that one? You know, these guys are teetering on the brink of being traitors to their country by actively undermining a president for political reasons, or maybe something else besides politics.
So how objective can we
suggest that?
How objective can a person be in considering how much of certain behaviors would qualify a person to be, say, that we could say that person is evil?
I certainly am not a psychologist, but you know, if there's a pattern and a commitment, if that person is a person who has power, and he or she abuses that power to the detriment of others in a long-term pattern, and the outcome is always for self-service, then I'd say that evil lives.
Why do you think the Republican Congress has taken this attitude toward Obama, that he would not succeed at anything he does? Why would they do that?
Well, he's smarter than they are.
Number one.
Yeah. Number two, he won over 50% of the electorate twice. He's brown.
Uh-huh.
And I think that those three factors have these guys. And I forgot one other thing. He tried to be a centrist, and they were in the business of hauling their buns to the right as fast as they could. And they were being pushed that way, I think, by their money people, the lobbyists. Did you know that in 1971, there were 1,000 lobbyists in Washington, D.C. That was the year that Lewis Powell wrote the infamous letter to the Chamber of Commerce calling for banking corporate America to purchase government. And since then, we now are experiencing over 45,000 lobbyists in Washington alone, not to say anything about who's lobbying the state houses. And all of this is coming from the people like the Koch brothers who set up all these foundations. You can see them on NPR. You know, you say the Koch, so-and-so Koch Foundation. That's a tax dodge, and they're sending that money to neo-political organizations to do their bidding to make you know, their agenda, part of our government, part of our nation.
I've been looking.
Without a vote.
I've been looking for a moment to find a chink in your armor.
Mine?
Yeah,
oh, there's probably lots of
found it.
Oh, good.
And you said Obama is brown.
Yeah.
Well, in their minds, Obama is black. So you softened it, because it's hard to
well,
accept.
Well, sometimes the sarcasm and satire, you know, it has to do with that. And that was my motive there. I didn't, you know, I could have said black, like Bill Maher says black, mm-hmm. you know, or slaps his head and goes, oh, gee, guess what? You know, I could have done that. But I thought that the underwhelming word was more powerful.
I love
but
it.
But you're the MC, so, you know.
No.
Find more chinks in
no,
my armor.
No. Yeah, I'm just curious about what's going to happen to us in November with this election and the outcome and what will happen to us and BRICS and Greece isn't over yet. At the beginning, and austerity is coming home to America right now.
It's been here. It's been here since 1982. That's when the Reagan administration introduced Reaganomics. And where do you think that came from? It came from Milton Friedman and the Chicago School of Business and their emphasis and their pillorying of the Congress to cut taxes for the rich, to cut. Reagan's administration tried to eliminate the Department of Education as a cabinet office.
Yeah.
Why? Why would they do that?
Because they never get enough.
Correct. And they also wanted education to be a profit center.
Ah.
End of story. So, you know, when Reaganomics came in, they ran into, you know, he wanted to go and rebuild the Navy. Remember the 600-ship Navy? So they set about building the Navy, and they went, oh, gosh, I guess we better raise taxes. So he had to raise taxes six times after he cut them for the richest. But guess where the tax raises went? To the middle class. He attacked labor unions. He didn't just pressure them, he attacked them. The air traffic controllers was just one example.
That was horrible.
It was dreadful. And, you know, I'm not saying that the unions are the be-all and end-all to labor issues, but, you know, without them, the working class in a capitalistic society is at risk of being impoverished. It happens every time. You can look it up. It's all in the history books. You know, if you look at feudal Europe, that's exactly what it was. It was the rich and the poor. There was no middle class.
What kind of a thing can Obama do in his waning years of his presidency?
Waning days.
That would, days. Thank you. Thank you. That would signal to the rest of the world that he is looking out for the welfare of ordinary citizens rather than the super rich and the ruling elite. What can he do? Would it be giving up Guantanamo? Would it be abandoning 50% of our bases in other countries around the world, or what?
No,
give me an idea.
No, none of that would matter. If he wants to show how humanitarian he is,
yeah.
I think it's too late. I just don't think there's anything he can do now. I really don't. I don't. I mean, he can say the words, he can make the tours, and do all that, but he's basically a lame duck right now. This Congress is doing nothing. This Congress is absolutely not going to do anything. And remember, it's the Congress that disposes. They're the ones who make the budget. They're the ones, well, they're the ones who decide in what the budget's going to look like. And they're the ones who decide how to enact it. They're not going to do anything he wants. They won't even approve a middle-of-the-road Supreme Court justice that he recommended. You know what my secret desire is?
But
that President Hillary Clinton, on his second day of office, after she sobers up from the inaugural ball, nominates Barack Obama to the Supreme Court of the United States.
With that, we're going to have to stop because I think they're going to blow us off the air, you know? Okay. It's time for us to stop because time is running out, that's why. And keep your pens and pencils handy because you may want to jot down something that we'll show you in the closing credits. Now, there is a public service announcement. My local broadcast schedule, go to my website, www.donbayham.com, and click on Present Day Activities. And to watch my shows on the web, Google Don Bayham YouTube. There's hundreds of shows of the ACLU, the American Civil Liberties Union. Without the ACLU, I think our civil liberties would be further in the tube than they are now. Mm-hmm. Go to that website, learn about the ACLU, get my shows broadcast by other stations. Ask your local public access station to go to www.pegmedia.org and follow the instructions there so that we can be broadcast. Oh, we got to end corporate personhood. Go to www.movetoamend.org. Corporations are not persons and money is not speech. We've got to amend the Constitution. Yeah. Thanks for watching. Remember KFC? Don't forget KFC. Not that KFC, not Kentucky Fried Chicken, Dr. Don's KFC. Kind, friendly, and charitable. Be kind, be friendly, and be charitable to you too. And you too. And you too. And the control room and Mr. and everybody. Thank you so much for watching. Not quite. Yeah.